So this year at BSMS, we're celebrating women leaders in health and medicine who make this world a better place. Dr. Dhairyawan is a consultant in sexual health and HIV medicine at Barts Health NHS Trust, where she carries out inpatient HIV care and HIV clinics. She's an honorary senior lecturer at Queen Mary University of London, and her research and advocacy focus on reducing health inequalities in sexual health and beyond, particularly for women of color. She's a co-founder of the South Asian HIV Advisory Resource and medical advisor to NAS, a charity aimed at improving the sexual health of racially minoritized communities. She's also a trustee of the Supporting Women with HIV Information Network, SWIFT, and chairs the steering group of 4M, a national network of perinatal HIV mentors. Dr. Dhairyawan chairs the British HIV Association External Relations Subcommittee and is education lead for advocacy group Race and Health. Wow. Well, this year's campaign theme for International Women's Day is Choose to Challenge. And Dr. Dhairyawan is the type of leader in medicine that we could use more of. She has dedicated her career to challenging the status quo and fighting for more equitable health outcomes. So before we start, just to let you know, a recording will be made available and sent to you after this session. And we'd love to hear from you. So please use the chat function to write any questions you may have. Dr. Dhairyawan's talk will take about 40 minutes and she will answer those questions after. So without further ado, welcome Dr. Dhairyawan.
Thank you so much, Maria. I'm just gonna attempt to share my screen and hopefully you'll all be able to see my presentation. Here it is, wonderful. Okay, so I think first of all, I just want to really say an absolute huge thanks to Brighton Medical School for this invite to give a talk on International Women's Day, and particularly Maria and Matt, who's behind the scenes, for the invite. It's a real honour to be asked to give this talk, and I really hope that you find it interesting and thought-provoking, especially for the medical students that are attending. And it's also really nice, I can see from the participants, there's some people there that I know from the Lawson HIV unit in Brighton, so hello to them. So Sunita and Kate, etc. Thanks for joining the talk today. So this session has been entitled, Does Gender Affect Health Outcomes for Women? And essentially the answer is yes. What I plan to do the rest of this talk is talk about how that happens. So in terms of the plan, using HIV as an example, because I'm an HIV doctor, I'll discuss how being a woman can affect health outcomes with regards to accessing care, taking treatment, staying engaged in care. And although I'm using HIV as an example, many of the factors that I discuss are important in terms of other aspects of health that affect women. I'm going to be talking about a topic called testimonial injustice and gender bias and how that impacts on healthcare and also health workers in the NHS and beyond, and also a bit about the gendered impact of COVID, because I think it's difficult, unfortunately, to do a talk without mentioning COVID at the moment. So I said I was going to talk about HIV, and hopefully many of you will have watched the Channel 4 drama that has been on earlier this year called It's a Sin. And if you haven't, I really urge that you do. It's a really fantastic bi-part drama on Channel 4, looking at really the early days of HIV in the 80s in London, looking at a group of friends. And in terms of what it shows how HIV used to be. So that was before we had treatment, before we knew much about how it was transmitted, and looked a lot at the stigma that living with HIV can cause. But of course, things have really changed since then. And I just want to give a quick run through where we are in HIV at the moment for people who aren't HIV specialists. So important to know about the 90-90-90 targets. So UNAIDS has the aspiration of ending HIV and AIDS as a public health threat by 2030. And this is something that many countries around the world are signing up to. And in the UK, we hope there'll be no more HIV transmissions by 2030. So that's not long. And the way they want to monitor progress towards this are with these 90-90-90 targets. So what they want is that around the world, 90% of all people living with HIV will know their status, so they will have been tested. And of those people who know their status, they should be on antiretroviral therapy. And of the people who are on treatment, they should have an undetectable viral load or be virally suppressed, meaning they're on effective treatment. And actually, that's something that we're very good at here in the UK. And you can see that if, in terms of our Public Health England figures, if you look at our cascade of care from the 1990-90 targets in the UK, 94% of people living with HIV know they have it, so they've been diagnosed. And of those amount of people, 98% are on treatment. And of those people on treatment, 97% are virally suppressed. So we've already exceeded the targets and we're doing very well. And because of our successes, you can see that the people who attend for HIV care in the UK are getting older. So this graph looks at the age of people attending HIV clinics between 2007 and 2016. So people who acquired HIV when they were younger are getting older because they're no longer dying from HIV. And we're picking up people who acquire HIV when they're getting older as well. So that's good news. And the really effective treatment that we have, which is now often just one or two tablets a day, means that people living with HIV can expect to live a normal life expectancy. And we now have many ways to prevent people getting HIV. As well as condoms, for example, there is a tablet that you can take to prevent you getting HIV called PrEP. We know that if people test frequently, then their HIV gets diagnosed earlier, and it means that they can get on treatment earlier. And we also now know that if people are on treatment and they have an undetectable viral load, that they cannot pass on HIV to their sexual partners. And we really think that this is key to ending the HIV epidemic. If we can test everyone and make sure everyone who's HIV positive is on treatment, then they won't pass it on. So there's been some really huge successes since the 1980s when It's a Sin was based. But if you have seen the programme, what you might have noticed is that it has focused on only the stories of a few people. And it's very understandable why, because it was only a short series and they could only concentrate on some stories. But there were no women living with HIV in the series, unfortunately. And this is a really kind of big running theme around health generally, the invisibility of women when it comes to healthcare. And I've just got a poster here from a recent campaign by the Terence Higgins Trust and Sophia Forum called Invisible No Longer. So pledging to make sure that women are invisible no longer when it comes to HIV. And, you know, it is surprising that women have been invisible because actually, if you look globally in terms of who's living with HIV, there are more women than men. So it was estimated that in 2019 by the World Health Organization that there are approximately 19.2 million women living with HIV around the world and 17 million men. And what about the situation in the UK? So this was a specific report, the first ever report looking specifically at women living with HIV by Public Health England. And that showed that women probably make up about a third of people living with HIV in the UK. So there are just under 30,000 women living with diagnosed HIV infection. And of those women, 114 were reported as being transgender. And they made up about a quarter of the total number of HIV diagnoses. Concerningly, half the women were diagnosed late. And what that means is that if you're diagnosed late with HIV, it means the virus has had a chance to impact on the immune system, causing damage. And it's one of the most important predictors of HIV-related death and morbidity. So it's really important we diagnose people early. So it is of concern that half of the women were diagnosed late. And we think of the women who were diagnosed, more than half of them probably got their HIV in the UK. And in terms of who those women are living with HIV in the UK, it's important to understand that more than three quarters of them are from ethnic minorities, with the majority being Black African. So thinking about gender differences in HIV as a whole, as I said, there's more women than men living with HIV. And globally, in terms of new infections, 3 in 5 new infections amongst young people aged 15 to 24 are in women and girls. So in terms of younger ages, there are a lot of young girls and young women getting HIV. So that's about 5,500 young women a week. And in terms of trans women, there was a big meta-analysis of data from 39 studies conducted in 15 countries, and they reported a global HIV prevalence of trans women of nearly 20%, with trans women estimated to be 49 times more likely than other groups to be living with HIV. So they're also disproportionately affected. In terms of why women are more likely to get HIV, there has been some data on possible biological susceptibility, so perhaps something to do with the vaginal microbiome, so the bacteria that live in the vagina, something about the lining of the womb perhaps being thinner, meaning that women are more likely to get the virus because it's easier for it to pass through during sex, and possibly something about the effect of sex hormones, meaning that women are more likely to get HIV, but that's all, the data for that is conflicting. And we know that once women get HIV, there's no evidence in terms of how effective treatment is. So it's just as effective in women as men, but there are possible differences in tolerability, so that women may tend to get more side effects. But we know that HIV disproportionately affects cis and transgender women and adolescent girls because of the vulnerabilities created by unequal cultural and social economic status. And this by far is the biggest factor leading to higher rates of HIV in women around the world. So I'm going to talk a bit more about that, about some of the factors that might lead to the increased risk of getting HIV, and also the factors that may impact on women's ability to engage in healthcare and to take treatment. So first of all, I think we need to think about traditional gender roles around the world. So thinking about women. So first of all, let's think about education. So we know that in some countries, 6 out of 10 girls do not attend secondary school. And this is really important for many reasons. But we do know that, for example, some studies in sub-Saharan Africa, that girls who don't attend high school are twice as likely to get HIV. So the amount of education may impact on acquiring HIV. And we also know that girls who are more educated are more likely to marry later, more likely to have children later on, and exercise greater control over their fertility. We also know globally there's a huge gender pay gap, and that's being discussed a lot in this country. But just to give you some stats around that, globally, women make up over 48% of the global workforce, but they earn 20% less than men doing the same work. And there's also a huge amount of unpaid labour that women do. And this tends to be especially to do with caring. So caring for children, caring for older family members. And the UK Carers Association reported in 2016 that they estimated that £77 billion per year was basically the value of the unpaid care that women gave in the UK. So that's a huge amount of work that isn't paid for. Work that, you know, should be paid, and women should be getting that those wages. So and the United Nations say that the uneven distribution of unpaid care is an infringement of human rights and a huge break on economic empowerment. So these huge things, so women do the work, they're not getting paid for it, and it impacts on their ability to be able to make their own choices around life, etc., and that can impact on their health. I also wanted to bring up The Second Shift. So The Second Shift was actually a book that was published in the 80s, but this really talks about how women may go to work, but then they may come home and do what's known as a second shift. So they may be more likely to do the childcare, more likely to cook and clean and do housework. So again, that may impact on their ability in terms of how much they can work in terms of work that pays them wages. And we also need to think about legal rights as well. So in terms of women around the world, women have less right to be able to divorce, for example, less right to be able to inherit, and less right to own property. So all these issues that are related to kind of traditional gender roles about women mean that they are less able to take part in society, less able to have, less able to decide what they want to do. And as I said, this can all impact on their health. So that's a really important issue. Another important issue which can affect healthcare is violence against women. And a big study done earlier in this millennium, so in the 2000s, was a global survey. And this looked at how common violence against women is. And this looked at partner violence. And it actually found that 1 in 3 women around the world experience physical and or sexual violence by a partner. So that is obviously huge. and it's a public health issue which has huge impacts on health. So we know that it has impacts on mental health, with women experiencing partner violence being twice as likely to experience depression, being almost twice as likely to have alcohol use disorders, being more likely to have problems with their reproductive health, so more likely to have low birth weight babies, for example. They're more likely to acquire STIs such as HIV. And of course, in terms of trauma and injury, we know that 38% of murders of all women globally were reported as being committed by their partners. And 42% of women who have experienced violence at the hands of their partner have experienced injuries as a result. So this is a huge public health issue which affects many women around the world. And with regards to HIV in particular, there are lots of links between violence and HIV. So we know that in some settings, up to 45% of adolescent girls report that their first sexual experience was forced. And as I said earlier, we know that partner violence increases the risk of HIV acquisition by 1.5 times. And the reason for this is that partner violence, so we can think of sexual violence, for example, we know that if someone is forced into having sex, there may be increased chance of transmission if the sex is rougher, for example. We know that women who may be in abusive relationships may have less autonomy and ability to choose whether they can use condoms, to be able to choose when they want to have sex, and that can increase their risk. And also the long-term impacts of abuse. So, for example, on mental health and increased risk of substance abuse means that women may not have the autonomy or the self-esteem to be able to decide when they have sex and who with and whether they use condoms. So all those things put together mean that women are at increased risk of HIV if they've experienced violence. And in terms of how common it is for women living with HIV to have experienced violence, we actually did a study in our clinic at the Homerton Hospital in Hackney a few years ago, and we asked all of the women attending our HIV clinic if they'd experienced partner violence, and we found that the prevalence was 52%. And if you compare that to the prevalence in the general population in the UK, which is about 25%, we found, therefore, that women living with HIV was twice as likely as the general population to have experienced violence. And a global survey was done, which interviewed women living with HIV around the world, and the prevalence there was found to be as high as 89%. So it's important to think about the links between HIV and violence. They are inextricably linked. And also, living with HIV can lead to violence as well. So we know a really risky time for women is when they decide to share their HIV status. So if they're already in a violent relationship, it may cause it to escalate, or it may even instigate violence. And that's really important for us to think about as healthcare professionals, because we advocate for women to share their status with their partners for partner notification and testing. But of course, this may not be possible if the partner is violent or if the woman fears violence from the partner. And if a woman is experiencing violence or has experienced violence, it can impact on their ability to take treatment, to engage in care, and as I said, to share their status with others. So partner violence is a global health threat, a public health threat, which can affect the healthcare of women in many different ways. And the last thing I wanted to say in terms of HIV is that it's not just a violence from partners, there's also institutional violence. So we know that involuntary and coerced sterilization and forced abortion has been present amongst women living with HIV, and it's been reported in at least 14 countries worldwide. So it's not just violence from partners, it can be from healthcare institutions as well. So I'm just going to bring this in here, and I'm sure many of you may have heard about it before, but I want to bring this in because I think it's important that when we talk about women, we think about specific groups and obviously acknowledge that not all women are the same. So many of you will have heard of intersectionality, and this is a theory by Kimberly Crenshaw, law professor in 1989, and she was using it in law to kind of describe the experiences of Black women in the legal system. And it's defined as a theoretical framework for understanding how aspects of a person's social and political identities combine to create unique modes of discrimination and privilege. So for Black women, they'll experience sexism because they're women, but they will also experience racism because they're Black. And some of the identities that we can think of that may combine to cause different levels of discrimination can include, for example, gender, so sexism, transphobia, race, causing racism or xenophobia, class, sexuality, disability, age, living with HIV, and also discrimination against other key populations. And I wanted to choose a couple of groups of women to think about when it comes to HIV, just as an example of intersectionality. So first of all, I want to think about women who living with HIV from racially minoritized groups and how their experiences may differ from that of white women. So these are this is some data which does show differences. So in the UK, as I've already said, in terms of women living with HIV, 80% are racially minoritized. And there's a real difference there when it comes to late diagnosis, which, as I said, is one of the main determinants of HIV-related mortality and morbidity. So 63% of Black Caribbean women and 53% of Black African women have experienced late diagnosis, compared to 47% of white women. When we look at the US, there are differences by ethnicity in terms of HIV prevalence in trans women. So overall, the prevalence is 14%. But that's 44% of African-American trans women, 26% of Hispanic, and 7% of white trans women. So again, that's important when we think about HIV prevention and testing. And a study that we did in the UK, so we did an analysis of the PRIME study, and this is a study looking at experiences of menopause and experiences of older women living with HIV. And we found some differences in terms of mental health and socioeconomic status by ethnicity. So we found that amongst older women, Black women living with HIV were more likely to have a university degree, but more likely to be unemployed. So although they were highly educated, they weren't employed. They were less likely to have enough money for basic needs, and they were more likely to report severe psychological distress, but less likely to be on antidepressants. So again, showing some barriers there towards mental health care. So it's really important to think about the different groups of women and not think they all have the same experiences. Another example I want to use are amongst trans and gender diverse people. So they're thinking about their experiences in terms of HIV. So in the UK, we know that they're twice as likely to be diagnosed late. And there are many social stresses and structural inequalities which place them at increased risk of HIV infection. So these include their experiences of a hate crime. So a Stonewall survey found that 2 in 5 trans people had experienced a hate crime because of their gender identity. And more than a quarter who were in a relationship had faced partner violence. 1 in 4 had experienced homelessness. And that social vulnerability and experiences of transphobia have had big impacts on mental health, which can manifest in alcohol and substance misuse and an increased risk of depression, anxiety, and suicidal ideation. And there's also a higher prevalence of history of sex work in trans women than amongst other groups. So all these things together can put trans women at higher risk of getting HIV. And again, it can also impact on their ability to access healthcare. So a big survey looking at HIV stigma in 2016 found that trans women demonstrated concerns about being treated differently by healthcare providers across a range of settings, and that put them off from attending healthcare as a result. However, good news, Public Health England reported specifically on trans people living with HIV this year. And they found that they were just as likely to start treatment and to be virally suppressed as other groups. But however, what has been really pointed out in the last few years is the real paucity of data in the UK about trans people and gender diverse people living with HIV, which is reflected in health generally. So I want to now talk a bit about lack of data amongst women in health generally. And there is a research health gap in that there are many conditions that affect women, of which we have less research and less knowledge about. And in terms of clinical trials, there is less data on how women do. So there was a study looking at the representation of women in clinical trials. And this study looked at 544 HIV studies, and they found that women only represented 23% of participants, and that the barriers to participation included logistical barriers, so not being able to attend the trial unit because of childcare, because of work, because of the timings, etc. There were strict exclusions, so women had to, for example, be on 2 types of contraception with very regular very regular pregnancy testing, which put many women off from taking part in trials, and also exclusion of women who are breastfeeding. Researchers found that perhaps women aren't taught as well about what being in research means, and there's a need for better research literacy. So clinical trials units need to be better at talking about research to potential participants, and also a worry about being treated as guinea pigs. So mistrust about being in clinical trials and concerns about confidentiality. And why is this important? Well, it's important that we have a diverse, when we're testing something, so for example, if it's a drug, it's important that we have a diverse population of people that we test the drug on, so we get a full idea of how the drug affects people in different ways, because of course it's going to be used by the general population. So the more diverse our trial sample is, the better we know about the drug and how it will be tolerated or used in real life. And I've taken this slide from my colleague, Dr. Shima Tarek, who's a researcher at UCL, and in terms of what works, what can we do to involve more women in clinical trials? So in HIV, it's really important that we include women living with HIV right from the beginning in terms of thinking about what research should do, thinking about how to design the study, how to get funding, running the trial, analysing the results and disseminating the information, because there's no point doing research unless it matters to the population that we're doing the research on. So making sure that we have research questions that matter, and that will also help may interest more women in taking part in research because they might feel it applies to them. We need to be better at improving community research literacy. So as I said, making sure we're better explaining what research involves and why we're doing it. And then we need to address logistical barriers, so clinic hours, transport and childcare, making it accessible for more people. So I'm going to take a little segue here, because I think I've spent now about half an hour talking about health inequalities. So some of the things I've talked about in terms of women and HIV are applicable to other areas of health. So thinking about, again, as I said, about traditional gender roles, about the impact of intimate partner violence, about the lack of data and trial participation, that can affect women in all aspects of healthcare. I'm going to take a little segue to talk about testimonial injustice, which is something that can affect anyone, but particularly women. And this is a card. So it was my birthday a few weeks back, and my friend sent me this card, which really made me laugh. So you've convinced everyone else you're grown up, but you don't fool me. And that is something that I think I felt particularly today. I felt like, gosh, it's me, just me doing a talk to Brighton Medical School. So I have to say my feelings of imposter syndrome were strong today. And I just want to talk a bit about testimonial injustice and imposter syndrome, because it can affect many people, and just to talk a bit more about what it is. So testimonial injustice. So this is a philosophical term, and it was written about by Miranda Fricker, who's a UK philosopher, and she wrote it in her book Epistemic Injustice, Power and the Ethics of Knowing, which was published in 2007. And what this is testimonial injustice occurs when the listener discounts the credibility of the speaker's word due to prejudice about their social identity, and is often associated with gender, ethnicity, class, sexuality, or religion. The speaker experiences a credibility deficit. So you may be wondering why I'm bringing this up, but I hope to show you that this is important when we think about healthcare in terms of the experiences of patients who experience testimonial injustice, but also for people working in healthcare and in research. So essentially, it's about being listened to, and people may be less likely to listen to someone due to their social identity. So this is something that may happen more to women. So when we think about it with regards to patient experiences, women are more likely to experience testimonial injustice, especially racially minoritized women. So essentially, they're not listened to or taken seriously. And this is something that women may identify with when they go to their doctor and tell them about their symptoms and being told, perhaps, you know, perhaps it's not as bad as you think. Perhaps you're very stressed. Perhaps it's a woman's problem. And then a good example of women experiencing testimonial injustice is with endometriosis. And this is quite timely because it is Endometriosis Awareness Month at the moment. So we know that endometriosis, which is a disease where the lining of where cells which normally line the womb can be found around the rest of the body, can cause a lot of pain, and it has been described as being as bad as having a heart attack. So women live with this pain on a monthly basis when they menstruate. And the problem with endometriosis is that it's often diagnosed late, and the average time to diagnosis is 8 years in the UK. And women will often say that they've been to their doctor many times and said, "I've had excruciating period pains," and being told that, "Well, this is just normal and you'll just have to put up with it." So this is a real example of testimonial injustice experienced by women, in that their symptoms have not been taken seriously. They haven't been referred to gynecology, for example, to have investigations done or treatment. Another good example was recently with the vaginal mesh scandal, where women who had had vaginal meshes reported problems with them, again, concerning pain. And a recent review found that patients were disbelieved when raising their concerns about vaginal meshes and other symptoms, and they were told that they were just having women's problems. So again, this kind of not taking seriously of what is a serious issue for women. So testimonial injustice can affect patients, and it can also affect people in other areas of life, and this is important in health. So thinking about workplace experiences, a really common example, which certainly happened to me and made other people who are watching this may identify with it as well. So you may experience testimonial injustice if you're in a meeting and you make a point and no one kind of says anything, it's kind of ignored, it's moved on. And then later someone else in the meeting says the same point and is praised for it. So that other person may be seen as being more credible than you, but not necessarily more competent. So that's a very common experience of testimonial injustice. And one of the issues of that is if it happens repeatedly to someone, it may put them off from speaking up in future meetings and may erode their self-esteem. So, you know, certainly I've been in meetings where I think, oh, no one's listened to me. I can't bother to say, make this point again. So, you know, this is something that can happen repeatedly, can affect self-esteem. And the problem with it is it can have a real long-term impact on careers. So we know that if people have less self-esteem, they may be less likely to pursue opportunities for their career, for example, to sit on boards or to apply for leadership positions. And this is really important for healthcare, because if it happens to women working in healthcare or people from other minoritized groups, it may result in their views or opinions being lost. And that's particularly of importance in bodies that make decisions that determine the allocation of resources. So for funding boards, for example, or on editorial boards, which determine the distribution of knowledge. So if there's less women on these boards, then women's issues may not get prioritized as much. And I think a really good example of testimonial injustice on a wider scale happening to women working in healthcare and research has been really highlighted with COVID this year. So, this might come out a little bit small, but this is the issue of untitling or uncredentialing women. So this is where women's titles are omitted, and this really diminishes a woman's perceived authority and credibility, so they're seen less credible. And this is a tweet from Professor Claire Hopkins, who is a very eminent ENT surgeon, and she was on BBC Breakfast along with another professor in ENT, and you can see that he had his title professor, where she didn't have any title at all. So this really may make her seem less credible, even though she has the same authority and competence as the man. And this is not only obviously in terms of the media, it's in other areas as well. And this recent study was done, which looked at grand rounds in hospitals. And they basically looked at how speakers were introduced. So if women were introducing speakers, they almost always used the correct titles for the male and female speakers that they introduced. But when men were introducing speakers, they used titles 72% of the time when they're introducing men, but only 49% of the time when they're introducing women. So this again can affect a woman's perceived credibility, which means she may be less likely to be listened to. And as I said, that can have important effects in terms of healthcare and funding in healthcare. So as I said, if the voices of women and minoritized groups are not on those boards which determine funding or what's published, this can further it means that the disease areas they're more likely to promote may not be prioritized as much, and they may not get the funding or attention they need. And I think endometriosis is a good example of that. It affects 1 in 10 women, yet there is still very little known about it in terms of the causes and what actually works to treat it. So this further embeds patterns of historical marginalization. And there's been reports in the news about closing the gender health gap. So this is the research gender health gap. An example of this is that despite a third of women experiencing a reproductive or gynecological problem in their lifetime, less than 2.5% of publicly funded research is allocated to this field. So this huge funding gap and knowledge gap. And actually what the government are doing, they've just announced in the last week, is they're asking for women to give their experiences of being a patient, so to offer them up, so that they can find out more about the health gap and look to address it. So I think that's a very positive thing. So I mentioned imposter syndrome in my birthday card before. And as I said, I think it's something that many people experience, but particularly women and people from other minoritized groups. And it's often seen as an individual problem. So you're often given advice to work on your imposter syndrome, so build your confidence, etc. But if we think actually that imposter syndrome is associated with experiencing repeated instances of testimonial injustice, then this means that we need a collective, not an individual solution. So it's actually not just up to us to improve it. We need structural changes. So for example, in healthcare, we need to make sure that groups with the power to make important decisions about resource allocation, so funding and knowledge and distribution, are not only diverse, so diversity is good, but we need to make sure that everyone's voices are actively valued and heard. There's no point having a diverse board if not everyone gets to speak and not everyone is taken seriously or seen as being credible and having valuable opinions. And this would have a huge impact on our patients and our workforce. So just looking at time, I'm just going to finish talking quickly about COVID, as I said. So in terms of the direct health impacts of COVID, we do know that men have been more affected. There's certainly been a much higher mortality rate experienced by men. But we know that women have had the impact of, have been severely impacted by the economic and social consequences of COVID. And this recent report from UN Women looks at this specifically. And the reason that women are more impacted are is because the majority of frontline health workers are women. There's also been a huge increase in domestic violence and a reportedly 400% increase in the demand for violence against women's services. And of course, in lockdown, it's much harder for women to get away from their perpetrator. Women have had to take on the burden of caregiving, which is unpaid, as we said before. And there may be more caregiving, for example, where children can't go to school because of lockdown. Women may have the burden of doing the homeschooling, for example. And women are more likely to work in precarious jobs. So they found that in 55 high and middle income countries, 29.4 million women lost their jobs in the first wave of the pandemic. And worryingly, UN Women predict that these gendered impacts will drive 47 million more women into extreme poverty in 2021. So unfortunately, although we've made a lot of progress over the last few years in terms of women's empowerment, COVID is working against that. And we need to be really careful that this doesn't make things even more worse. And UN Women have made a lot of recommendations regarding this, so around protecting women's health, introducing economic support packages for vulnerable women, addressing the economic impacts of the pandemic, investing in social protection schemes, prioritising prevention of violence against women and ensuring services are funded, and importantly, improving gender data collection and expanding research into the gender impacts of COVID, and also looking specifically at how the pandemic has affected different groups of women differently. And it's also affected research into COVID. So this is a study that's just been published by a couple of my colleagues in HIV medicine, so Muga Cevic and Chloe Orkin. And what they noticed was that before COVID, women tended to occupy fewer leadership positions in research. they led fewer funded studies and applied for and received less grant funding than men. So that what they wanted to do was to see what was happening with COVID trials. So they searched a database of all COVID-19 clinical trials from the 1st of January to the 26th of June last year, and recorded the gender of the principal investigator using, I think, quite a complex algorithm. They then compared this data to clinical trials on breast cancer and type 2 diabetes over the same period. And what they found was that in terms of the principal investigators for COVID trials, only 27.8% were women. And that was much lower when compared to 54.9% of breast cancer trials and 42.1% of diabetes trials. So clearly a big disparity in terms of who's doing research into COVID. And again, as we said, it's important that researchers are diverse, because it means that the research that is created and produced is able to represent more people in the general population, and it's the right research with the right questions. So for example, the right research questions for the lives of women. One of the reasons they suggested that, because research has to be done at a fast pace because we're in a pandemic, this may have contributed to the lack of women. There may have been less equality and diversity checks, for example. And their research coincides with data that's since come out across all disciplines, which found that despite an increased number of peer-reviewed articles submitted to journals during the pandemic, women published fewer papers than men in 2020. And again, that may be related to working from home, having to do childcare at the same time, meaning that women have been less likely to be as productive as men, especially if they're parents. So I'm going to finish here by saying that women in all of their diversity may face inequalities in access to health care and health outcomes because of the vulnerabilities created by unequal cultural, social and economic status. And women have been invisible, they've been underrepresented in research, policy and leadership positions. And COVID-19 is exacerbating these health inequalities and gender inequality. So this International Women's Day, let's choose to challenge gender bias and health inequality. So please join me in that. And I want to end by thanking some of the significant women in my life who've helped. So this photo on the left is me and my family back in 1982. I'm the young one with the check coat. So I just really want to thank my mum and my sister, who are both doctors, for being a great example to me and inspiring me, as well as my current colleagues who I've been working with in HIV for the last decade and more. And particularly want to thank the women living with HIV that I work with, from whom I have learned so much and continue to learn from. So going to end here is my this is a photo from one of the last time I was in Brighton. I managed to catch this amazing seagull in flight. This is my email address or my Twitter handle if anyone wants to get in touch. And I just want to thank you very much for listening to me, and look forward to the discussion. Thank you.
Brilliant. Thank you so much, Rageshri, for this really, wonderful talk. I have a few questions, so I'm just going to read them out to you, if that's okay. Alessandra is asking, could you elaborate on some of the reasons why trans and gender diverse people are diagnosed late with HIV?
So I think it may be related to access to healthcare. So I always think people need to know, one, that they're at risk of getting HIV. They need to know how to get an HIV test and where to access treatment if they're diagnosed. And they need to know about HIV prevention tools like PrEP. And I think perhaps we could do better in terms of our health promotion and making sure we get information out in the right way to the right people. And I think we're probably not doing that well enough in terms of trans and gender diverse people. And I think what has really helped in the last few years have been some of the fantastic community organisations such as Clinic Q, which is a clinic which is specifically for this population who do brilliant work in terms of sexual health and more for trans and gender diverse people. So I think we need more of that, but obviously this needs to be funded, and actually all clinics should be good at doing this work. So I think there's a lot we need to do to get that information out so people can benefit from it.
Great, thank you. What do you think people can do in their day-to-day lives to challenge gender inequalities?
Wow, that's a huge question. I think one is, I guess it depends. I think it's one about having the interest. So I think if that's something you're interested in doing, then perhaps you may want to do some, you may want to incorporate it into your day-to-day life or your job. So you could get involved with women's networks, for example, at work, look at perhaps mentoring younger women or students. And then if you're interested around kind of women's health in general, I think thinking about whether if there's any research questions or audits you have, which look specifically at women, there's a huge kind of data gap. So I think if you have a question, then look at how you can perhaps study it further. And one of the things that has really helped me since I was a registrar was getting involved with HIV charities, especially those to do with women. And as I said, I've learned a lot about women's health and kind of the specific needs of women through doing that. So yeah, getting involved with charities is a really great way of doing it.
Great. We have an anonymous question. Do you think we will ever reach a point where diversity checks and programs are not necessary for a varied representation in medicine? And if this is the case, do you think we actually should get rid of these programs once we reach that point, at a risk of being outdated, or should there always be a backup?
I think we always have to monitor it. And I think medicine and healthcare reflect society. So I think, unfortunately, it would be optimistic to say that, you know, we will completely get rid of all these different biases. But I think measuring it so we know what we have to work towards and knowing what works is always essential. So I think there'll always be a need to measure it. And I hope that it will be less needed. You know, we'll make great advances. And I think particularly with COVID, it's really highlighted the many health inequalities that different populations face. So I feel this is a really great time for people to work on equality and diversity. So yeah, if you're interested, go for it.
Great. Yeah, we have a comment from when you were talking about testimonial injustice saying, OMG, that happened to me so many times, especially in a group of men. And then another question, what is the government doing about combating these high figures of HIV in ethnic minorities?
There has recently been a big report by the HIV Commission looking at how we can make sure, for example, that everyone who has HIV knows, so increasing testing, and that looks specifically at some ethnic minority groups. I think there needs to be more action that is focused particularly on ethnicity. I think sometimes it can get kind of swallowed up in looking at all the different kind of groups that are more affected by HIV, but I think there probably needs to be slightly more focus. But there is lots of work being done, and again, lots and lots of charity and community organizations such as NAS, which I work with, who are doing work towards this.
Great. Another question, how important do you think things like UK aid are in helping to end HIV transmissions around the world? Thinking specifically in terms of the proposed cuts of 0.7% and the impact that this might have on global health.
Yeah, I think it's a real worry. And I think there's already evidence that shows that because COVID has just taken all the funding in terms of research, in terms of aid, that it has affected in some countries access to other services. So there's been less emphasis on HIV, for example, and other diseases. So I think UK aid is really, really important. And I think we still need to continue funding it. And I think I do worry that if it's cut, or, you know, funding from other countries are cut, that it will impact hugely on the HIV epidemic. So we need to really monitor that closely to check that that doesn't happen.
Thank you. We have a plug from Daisy Holmes, who says, thank you so much. Such an interesting talk. Just want to plug the book Invisible Women, which talks about data bias in a man's world. Worth the read for anyone interested.
Yeah, I would definitely say that as well. It's a great book.
I have a question that I think might be interesting for some of our medical students. So you've talked a lot about discrimination, violence, institutional and within the family and communities, and you're a doctor. So I wonder, like, and you talked about how all of these wider issues affect health, right? So I'm wondering, like, for you, where does medicine begin and end? And how do you sort of like integrate all of these other issues that you talked about in your daily practice?
So I remember, I think quite early on when I was a junior doctor, attending a lecture, and they were talking about healthcare, and it was basically saying that most people's health is determined before they enter a healthcare institution. So most people's health is determined by the wider social determinants. And then obviously their experience in healthcare can also affect their health. But actually, we're right at the end of that. So for me, it's really important. For example, when I see a patient in clinic, I think about all the different things that are affecting their life, as well as what's happening in within the healthcare system. So, for example, in HIV, we talk a lot about taking treatment adherence. We need to take tablets every day, staying engaged in care. And, you know, if a patient's blood test show perhaps they haven't been able to take their tablets so well, or they've come off treatment, it's important for me, particularly when I see those patients, to think about what is it in their life that's preventing them from doing that. So, for example, it may be the fact that they have working multiple shift jobs, which means they sometimes forget to take their tablets, which can lead to a rise in their viral load. So thinking about that. And I think that's important in other parts of health as well. So when we think about social determinants, I think as doctors, we find it easier to concentrate on the stuff that we can help change. So say if a patient is smoking or they're obese, for example, we may say to them, you need to lose weight because, you know, your blood pressure is very high. So I'll see you in 6 months, see how you go. And then they come back in 6 months time and they haven't lost the weight. And then it kind of gets into a kind of, oh, why didn't you do that? And obviously thinking about the reasons, why is that person not able to lose weight? Is it because they can't afford to buy healthy food? We know that junk food is much cheaper. Have they not got the time to be able to cook that food? Have they not got the time to take part in exercise? All those things are really important in terms of how, in terms of a person's health. And it's not just what we can do as well. It's thinking about how we can help with the outside issues. And I think for me, being a healthcare worker, it's important to be an activist around the other things that affect people's health as well. And I know there's lots of great, you know, healthcare worker groups that do that, like MedAct, for example. And decolonizing contraception, great kind of healthcare groups that think about some of the wider structures that affect our patients' lives.
Brilliant, thank you. We've got a couple more questions. So this question has come up twice, asking about whether there are effective treatments for HIV and any research on the on a vaccine to prevent transmission of HIV.
So there has been lots of vaccine trials done, but we still don't have an effective vaccine. I think there's a few reasons for that. One of them is that, so when you compare it to COVID, where we amazingly managed to develop a vaccine within a year, I think one of the reasons is that HIV tends to mutate more quickly than COVID. So it's from a kind of virology reason, it's been more difficult. But I also think there's something about intent. So with COVID, so much money has been put into developing a vaccine. We've had all the global kind of health funding being put into vaccine studies, all the best brains in the world trying to get a vaccine. All that has created a COVID vaccine very quickly for good reason. But I wonder if we perhaps had the same funding and intent for HIV, whether we would have had a vaccine by now. And also thinking about who the disease affects. COVID affects everyone, obviously some groups disproportionately, but HIV affects more minoritized groups, and perhaps there has been less attention on those groups' healthcare over the decades. But hopefully there will be a vaccine soon, but if not, we have amazing treatment, and there's also a lot of cure research being done as well.
Great. Another question now from Richard DeVisser. Some research into gender and men's health is focused on how beliefs about gender affect healthy or unhealthy behaviors that lead to health outcomes. So, for example, men's beliefs about masculinity and alcohol use affect drinking. Men's beliefs about masculinity affect engagement with healthcare. We have also found that women's beliefs about masculinities and femininities affect their health-related behavior. A lot of the research reports outcomes for women versus men, but how do gender beliefs and different femininities affect differences in health behaviors and health outcomes among women?
So that's a really interesting question. And actually, I gave a talk on gender differences in HIV last year, and I talked a bit about men, and I used the past US president as a great example of perhaps a more traditionally masculine look at health. So in some societies where some notions of masculinity are seen as being more important, men may be less likely, for example, to access healthcare more quickly. They may be more likely to try and put up with having the condition because they want to be seen as being strong, for example. But obviously that is massively generalizing. We know that men are diverse and women are also diverse. So again, there may be some data showing that perhaps women are more likely to seek healthcare than men if they get ill. But as I said, there's lots of social structures that may prevent them from doing that. So not having the time to see their doctor, experiencing being in a coercive relationship, or et cetera. So I think there is some data out there, but I always approach that with caution because there is so much diversity within different genders, and also the different social structures affecting their ability to access healthcare as well.
Great. Another question, coming anonymous question. What can women themselves do to challenge testimonial injustice that they face in healthcare?
So I think one thing is perhaps thinking it's not your fault. It's not because of your deficiency. It's not because you're not as good as everyone else. It may be a problem with the people that are not able to listen to you. So I think that's a really important thing, not letting it affect your own self-esteem or put you off. But I think actually the solutions do have to be structural. So there's a really great example with there's a women's philosophy society whose name I completely forgot, but they have these instructions for seminars. So instead of you do an education thing and then people put their hands up, so normally the people who put their hands up first are more likely to be the more socially confident people who can be more likely to be men, for example, they get picked on first. So what they've said is actually changing the way in which seminars are chaired. So for example, giving a few minutes for people to collect their thoughts and come up with ideas, so they've had some time to process what they've heard, and then not always going for the first hand in the room. So perhaps deliberately picking people with a diverse range of social identities to make sure that the voices that aren't always heard are heard first. So those are kind of structural things that can be done to try and address that.
Thank you. Just one last question before we wrap up. How important is it to reach out to HIV charities, for example, to link up the medical and holistic care pathway?
I think it's really, really important. I think HIV charities and people from the HIV community have basically driven the way in which we care for people living with HIV. We wouldn't have the treatments that we have now without that community activism. So it's really important that they are at the table when decisions are made, but just being also very mindful that they need the funding to be able to do that. And with the massive cuts to kind of charities generally during the period of austerity, making sure that HIV charities are funded and continue to be able to have a voice and input on care is really a priority, I think.
Brilliant. Thank you so much, Rageshri. We've had loads of other comments saying that this was a great talk and thanking you. And people are also asking if slides will be made available. Yes, we will share a recording of this talk as soon as possible with everyone who's registered. And I think hopefully the talk will end up on YouTube as soon as possible. And thank you, Rageshri. Thank you for spending your day with us. And thank you for everything that you do to challenge inequities for women in all of our diversity.
Oh, thank you, Maria. And thank you, everyone, for listening. Really appreciate it.